Okay. Right. And welcome to the 24th meeting in 2022 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. We received apologies today from Stuart McMillan, MSP. So I'd like to welcome Jenny Minto, MSP, as substitute. And thank you very much for being able to be here, Jenny, and contributing. Thank you. Thank you. So the first item of business is a... The first item of business is a declaration of interest, and in accordance with Section 3 of the Code of Conduct, I invite Oliver Mundell, MSP, to declare any interest relevant to the remit of the committee.
I have no interest to declare, convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mundell, and welcome to the committee. Good to have you here. Before we move on, though, to the next item on the agenda, I'd like to take this opportunity on behalf of the committee to thank Graham Simpson, MSP, for his time with us. As both a member and convener of this committee over a number of years, Graham recognised the importance of delegated powers and was passionate in the need for their proper scrutiny, and we all wish him well in his new role. So, thank you to Graham. Next item of business, of which there seems to be a lot, is to decide whether to take items 6 and 7 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private?
Yes.
And we are. Thank you. So moving to agenda item 3 today, we are taking evidence on the Movable Transactions Scotland Bill. And first of all, I would like to welcome Lady Payton, Chair of the Scottish Law Commission. And along with Lady Payton is Professor George Gretton and Professor Andrew Stephen. I'd like to welcome you both as former commissioners SLC were heavily involved in the Commission's report on movable transactions, which was published in 2017. Right, so before we just kick off, I'd like to ask all, remind all attendees not to worry about turning on your microphones during this session, as these are controlled by broadcasting. And if you would like to come in a question, please raise your hand and we will bring you in. But before we move to questions, can I firstly invite Lady Payton to make some brief opening remarks? Lady Payton, thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. Well, as Chair of the Scottish Law Commission, I would like to commend this bill. First, it modernises the law of assignation, and secondly, it creates new statutory pledges. Both will be good for business. Both will help Scotland's economy as it emerges from the pandemic. So focusing first on statutory pledges, start-up businesses will be able to access finance even although they don't own any land or buildings. Land and buildings is the traditional way that banks secure their loans. So new businesses will be able to offer movable property as security, for example, vehicles, machine tools, patents, design rights, software licenses and trademarks. And these businesses will be able to keep possession of and title to this property and use it to generate turnover and profit. So by creating this new avenue to finance, the bill will enhance Scotland's attractiveness as an investment centre and also level up Scotland to be more equal with other modern law systems. So the bill will stop young Scottish entrepreneurs from being told to go elsewhere, for example, to go to England, where the law makes secured lending easier. The bill will stop complicated workarounds which are currently taking place as lawyers and clients try to get round the gap in the law. And the bill will also support the First Minister's Gender Pay Gap Action Plan. And I can explain that more, but obviously, historically, few women owned heritable property. Things are getting better in 2022, and I don't have the exact statistics, but it's a fact that women have difficulty starting up a business because they have difficulty getting finance. So the bill also, in addition to the statutory pledges, modernises the law relating to assignations. Currently, when claims for the payment of debts are being transferred from one person A to B, the paperwork involved is enormous. Letters have to be sent to all the debtors. So the bill offers a new system with registers which will cut down the paperwork. And importantly, the bill means that an effective transfer can be brought about when letters have not been sent to the debtors, although we should say that the debtors are still protected as they are entitled to be notified before they have to pay a new assignee. Now, Professor Gretton and Professor Stephen, who are sitting beside me, former lead commissioners in this project, will be able to explain this advantage in more detail. So I do commend this bill. It fills a big gap in Scots law to meet today's needs, and I invite the committee to take it forward. Thank you
very much, Lady Payton. That's a good outline rationale behind why the bill is being brought forward. And it's all very positive as far as I'm concerned. So we'll now move to questions from the committee. Questions can be answered by Lady Payton, Professor Gretton and Professor Stephen. If there's anything in particular any of our guests would like to be the lead answer on, please just let us know, just give us a wee wave and we'll be fine with that. And firstly, I'll just open up and there's a couple of or three wee questions here which I think have been answered before by the professors in particular, but I think that at this committee it would be very useful to have some outline on these. Can I first of all ask when the Scottish Law Commission, why did the Scottish Law Commission review the law on movable transactions, and bringing into that, how is Scots law comparable internationally, and did international comparisons inform what was proposed? Anyone care? Professor Gretton, thank you.
Yes, well, it's been apparent for a very long time, indeed since the 19th century, that Scots law is outdated, it's cumbersome in its operation in these areas. The position has got rather worse in recent years with the internationalisation of finance. There was a time when Scottish businesses would raise finance within Scotland and people would at least know the system, cumbersome though, and unsatisfactory though it was. But now finance has become internationalised very much. And furthermore, while Scotland has stood still, other countries have moved forward in these areas, assignation and what the bill calls statutory pledge. One's seen this modernisation happening, for example, in Australia and Canada, United States very much. The United States has been something of a leader in this area, other countries as well. And indeed that's been happening even in the last, say, 20 years. So Scotland now stands out, a bit like a sore thumb, unsatisfactory in these areas. There are workarounds, but the workarounds themselves are rather unsatisfactory and add costs. So the Scottish Law Commission has been aware of this for a long time and decided to tackle it. This is the result. Andrew, do you want to add anything? That's a very brief account.
Yes, thank you. Professor Gretton began the project as lead commissioner and then I succeeded him and we've both worked on it. I think it's fair to say that since devolution, the Scottish Parliament has done world-leading work on land law, but movable property needs to catch up. Some of your land law work has been done via the Scottish Law Commission, so the Land Registration, etc. Scotland Act 2012 was based on a report which Professor Gretton authored. It's not been the same. In fact, it's been totally different for movable property. We've stood still and we have got behind. In the two areas where the bill will make a difference, that is to say assignation and security over movable property, the last law reforming statute on assignation was in 1862. in my view, although this is a more subjective question, on security, this would be the biggest reform, or on wider rural property, it would be the biggest reform since the Sale of Goods Act of 1893. Floating charges, we may come to later, were introduced in 1961. Floating charges have a relatively narrow compass because only companies and certain corporations can grant them. But it's certainly the biggest piece of legislation on security law since 1961. I would argue it's the most significant piece of legislation on movable property generally in Scotland since 1893. So we are behind on this. It does not give Scots law a good reputation. It impacts on businesses. It's very important in my view that we take it forward, and that very much was what the Scottish Law Commission's consultees said, both in terms of should the Scottish Law Commission work in this area, and then when we had worked on it, whether they wanted the recommendations taken forward, and we found very strong support.
Good. That's really very, very helpful indeed from both of you. Thank you very much indeed for that. Can I just ask, of any previous attempts to reform the law in this area, which sounds as though there weren't very many, but anyway, why do you think these proposals at this time are more likely to work than anything previous in Scotland?
There have been, the possibility of reform has been looked at before, in particular in the area of pledges, security, that's to say, but rather half-heartedly. What happened with the Scottish Law Commission project was a huge amount of energy was put into it. Detailed analysis of the current law, detailed analysis of the problems of the current law, extensive consultation with the relevant stakeholders, and international comparison, and that's very important in this area. You have to know what's happening in other countries, both around the world and in Europe. So it was a major project and not a half-hearted project. So what we have here is I think, quite a sophisticated bill, very much up to international standards, that international finance will like. There's not only international finance, of course, I don't want to stress that too much, but Scottish finance will like as well.
Right. Okay, and thank you very much indeed. That's really, really helpful indeed, actually. So just move on to some more detail. And Jenny Minto, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel, for coming along to give evidence today. Lady Payton, I was very struck with your point about it modernising the law of assignation. So I'm interested to hear how the Bill's provisions on assignation on a practical level will change how businesses might access finance, and perhaps you can give some examples of this as well, and also specifically about the point that you made about the Gender Pay Gap Action Plan, in that women have difficulties, as you said, starting up businesses and perhaps accessing finance. Yes. For
could them. I deal with that latter point, and then I'll invite Professor Stephen to deal with the first point. The gender pay gap has been reflected very much in people who start up businesses. And in fact, the First Minister launching this action plan in 2019 said, it is still the case that more than 3/5 of new businesses are being started by men and less than 2/5 by women. And she referred to research suggesting that an increase in the level of female ownership of businesses would make the economy richer and all of Scotland more prosperous. Now, I can't give you precise statistics, and it may be that in 2022 things have moved on a bit since then, one hopes so. But nevertheless, it is the case that a woman going to seek finance to start up a business often can't offer heritable property, can't offer land, can't offer buildings, but nevertheless has a very good idea. And if she could be allowed to raise finance over movable property, which she has, maybe it's the items in her workshop or whatever it is that she's renting. She's renting the workshop, but has items which are of value cumulatively, could form the basis of a security. Well, this new statutory pledge will solve her problem, and there would be more women able to access finance. And in fact, Professor Stephen found You could perhaps hold it up. This is a...
I will give the committee this later. Oh, good, yes.
He'll explain.
It's a report by the World Bank, which I should have spotted earlier, but from 2019, and it actually has a whole section on gender finance. Now, I have to put a slight caveat on this, that the World Bank is particularly interested in developing countries, mm-hmm. and in terms of improving finance, and I wouldn't want to suggest, obviously, that Scotland is a developing country in that sense, but our laws here are almost like a developing country, we need to develop them. So there is actually international evidence that a modern mobile transactions law does help what's referred to in this report as gender finance. And so there is evidence beyond Scotland on this, which I think is valuable.
Yes, if I could just add to the Professor's comments there, they give examples in this World Bank report of women entrepreneurs who couldn't move forward, but then, for example, they give a Constance Swanaker, an artist and founder of a particular small business. She was able to use her design furniture and home accessories to obtain a loan, and ultimately was able to hire employees of 30 in number because of this facility. So
was that in Ghana, I think?
So Ghana's ahead.
Can I try and explain the assignation provisions? Many small businesses fail because people pay them late. In other words, they have a problem getting debtors to pay on time. And the advantage of the bill is to facilitate, in particular, invoice financing. So small businesses could sell their invoices to a bank or other financial institution, and then they get the money immediately. Now, admittedly, of course, the bank will charge for that. And one of the types of these processes is known as invoice discounting, because the discount is how the bank takes its fee. But at the moment, Scottish law is way behind on this. And to make it work, it's often done through English law or through trusts, which are quite a complex legal structure. So at the moment, what the business would need to do, or probably more the bank, we need to tell all the customers. And Lady Payton referred to lots of paperwork earlier, and that becomes very costly, contacting all the customers. It's also impossible, the example I typically use is a plumber saying, right, I will assign my invoices for the next 3 months to the bank. Now, that will include your shower work that has broken in 2 months' time. But until your shower has broken and you've called the plumber out, we don't know who you are. The debtor, we don't know the identity to the debtor. So the advantage of registration as an alternative to intimation is that you can have a single registration for all my invoices for the next 3 months. Much, much cheaper. I need to be clear, however, that the change only affects one of the two principal aspects of assignation. So at the moment, intimation has two main aspects. One is to transfer the debts to the bank or other assignee, and the other is to notify the debtor, to tell the debtor to pay the assignee. And I know there has been concern about registration being an alternative to intimation and consumers mm-hmm. being put in an awkward position because they don't know who they have to pay to. The bill doesn't affect the notification function of assignation. So it's crucial if the assignee wants the debtor to pay them and not to continue to pay to the assignor that there must still be intimation. So the notification function of assignation will continue. And of course, you then might naturally say to me, why on earth are we setting up a register and the keeper's having to invest all this time and money if there's still got to be intimation? The answer is that registration protects the assignee if the assignor becomes insolvent. So if the small business sadly becomes insolvent, the bank will be protected because the invoices are due to them now, and they at that point can intimate to the customer. So customers will not be affected by this reform in the sense that the introduction of registration as an alternative only changes or offers an alternative to the transfer function of intimation and not the notification function. And I want to try and make that clear because it is very technical. And I'm more than happy to help further. The final thing I would say, this is already going on. I've said it already, but I'll say it again. It's going on through workarounds. So small businesses are assigning their debts to banks without customers being told because there's a workaround, a trust behind the scenes, or the debts are being written under English law. So it's actually pretty neutral in terms of what's happening in practice, but it will definitely reduce costs. And it won't have an effect on customers, because they would only have to pay the bank if the bank still notifies. Does that help?
That's very helpful. Thank you, Professor Stephen. Professor Griffin, have you got anything you would like to add?
Yes, no, I entirely agree with that. Going back to my international theme, I'm sorry to harp on about it, but internationally, notification to debtors of a transfer is required. No other country I'm aware of. Sometimes it's done, it doesn't have to be registered at all, it's just done by the written documentation itself and nothing else. In many other countries, registration is involved, as it would be here. And on the whole, registration is the trend of the future, I think. That's what we're seeing around the world. Yes, I think that's the point I wanted to add. Perhaps I just said something else. People sometimes find the idea that debt's being transferred a bit odd. After all, if Professor Stephen owes me £20, I expect to get the money from Professor Stephen and he'll pay me and that's it. But in the business world, debt's very, very often transferred without being directly paid to the original creditor. Mm-hmm. And that's very important in the business world. And as Andrew has said, it does happen in Scotland at the moment, but only by workarounds, which are awkward and expensive. And, of course, ultimately the expense is passed on to the businesses involved.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, an easy example of why a debt might be transferred is it might not be due for 28 days. So the invoice says you've got 28 days to pay. So the customer can say, oh, right, I'll pay on day 27. Whereas if you sell it to the bank immediately, you get the money immediately as a small business, admittedly with the discount. And what the bill will hopefully do is reduce the size of the discount because the whole process becomes cheaper.
Okay, that's very helpful, yes. And I'm aware of that 28-day payment, and sometimes it's actually much longer than that, which would, as you've said, really impact on the cash flow of businesses. So just very quickly, just if you could let us know for the record what evidence you received which suggested that finance firms that would welcome this and that business would be keen to take advantage of these changes.
Our primary consultee in relation to this was the Federation of Small Businesses, who we met with and who, both at the time of the report, made supportive statements and also, I see, have submitted to the committee. And their particular concern was late payments of debts, the fact that small businesses go bankrupt before they get paid. And this would give an option. One of the things which the Federation of Small Businesses told us was they liked this because it wasn't compulsory. Businesses didn't have to do this. They might if they wanted to, but it gave them an extra route to get finance. So they were very, very supportive of it. Can I add just one more thing? It is very technical. Even Professor Gretton and I find the whole bill very technical. So in some ways, I would not expect a small business to be saying the law of vaccination needs to be reformed in the same way as a small business would not understand the technicalities of broadband or plumbing. It's so technical. the advantage of the bill, I hope, is it will make life easier. It will make the law easier. But in a sense, to criticise the current law, you need to know the current law. And it's just, it honestly is very complicated. And I wouldn't expect the average small business to know it in the same way as I don't understand how a smartphone or broadband works, but I want it to work. I want my broadband to be as good as possible. And I think we at the Scottish Law Commission want our law to be as good as possible. One of our advisory group members talked about infrastructure. So broadband is infrastructure. Mm-hmm. Transport is infrastructure. Law is infrastructure. So I would commend that view.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
And thank you very much. Thanks for the question, Jenny, and thank you for the answers. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I could just pick up a comment made by Professor Stephen in his opening remarks. And that's just in regard to floating charges, which is not in the bill. As you say, this type of law reform happens once in probably four generations. Were there any thought given to open up floating charges to individuals, to partnerships? And if not, why was that decided not to go down that route?
Could Professor Gretton start? Because this was raised in the discussion paper for which he was responsible. Unless he particularly wants me to start, I will, but it might be more natural for Professor Gretton to start.
The various things that could be said about that. There has been discussion of extending it to individuals and partnerships. There are difficulties there, but perhaps more broadly, the floating charge is in many ways unsatisfactory. It has a rather low ranking. I think, whereas the what is proposed here is in a way, to some extent, it covers the same field as a floating charge because it's about security for debt, but it operates in a very different way, and it's something which is very important to improve access to finance. In England, for example, you have both the floating charge and you have fixed security interests, which are not the same but comparable to what this bill would propose. And in England, they use both, and they don't regard them as one in place of the other. And that will continue to be the case in Scotland. You'd have, I'm sure, with lending, you'd typically get both being involved. So I think extending the floating charge to individuals and partnerships would not take matters much further forward. I think that's Andrew Lewis. Yes,
that's exactly right. You consulted on that. In other words, the discussion paper of 2011 consulted on that, and there was no support for extending floating charges further, but by the majority of consultees. A floating charge covers all someone's property, and that would certainly be inappropriate for consumers, the idea that everything could be taken by the creditor. And even for sole traders and partnerships, they are subject to personal insolvency law, in other words, the bankruptcy legislation, whereas companies are subject to corporate insolvency law, the Insolvency Act of 1986, and there are certain checks and balances in the Insolvency Act 1986 to protect employees of companies, for example, when they go insolvent. These don't exist in the personal insolvency legislation. Now, we could have recommended changing the personal insolvency legislation, but that, I think, makes things much wider and more difficult. So in being lead commissioner on the report, that was something that influenced me, that to extend floating charges further, for which there really wasn't support, would have meant revision of insolvency law, which would have gone beyond scope.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. I think that's just helpful that we've got that. The bill would reform the rules on delivery for possessory pledges.
Yes.
What practical impact will this have? And do you think there will be a continuing demand for these pledges beyond that of pawn brokers?
Okay, this is a very interesting question. Because of a case from 1856 called Hamilton against the Western Bank, it appears the only way that one can do pledge in Scotland is for me to pledge my pen, which is not very valuable, Lady Payton, but I will pledge it nonetheless. I have to physically give it to Lady Payton. Like pawn, which consumers do. Now, if my pen is one of my key assets, like my computers and my vehicles, this is no good to a small business. You've got to physically hand the thing over. But the case I mentioned suggests that's the only type of possessory pledge. Other countries, the law is clear that you can do possessory pledge by intimation. So say I have whiskey, and that whiskey is stored in an independent warehouse, I can tell the warehouse to hold it for the bank. So it's not clear under Scottish law at the moment, because of that case I mentioned, that you can do possessory pledge by notifying to a custodian. So the bill makes it clear you can do that, which may help our whiskey industry in terms of being clear that whiskey which they store in independent warehouses can be the subject of a possessory pledge. But the statutory pledge lets them go a step further. They could grant the security over the whiskey in their own warehouse rather than in the independent third-party warehouse. So that's a definite step forward. Why not just abolish possessory pledge? Well, pawn is reserved to the Consumer Credit Act of 1974, so the Scottish Parliament could not do that. But more widely for businesses, it is the international norm to have security created by either delivery, could be delivery by notification to an independent custodian, or by registration. So we're really following the international rules. My colleague, Professor Louise Gullifer at Cambridge, who's arguably the world leading expert on this, she mentions that in some African countries, I think they have reformed the law so it's non-possessory only. But as she says, the standard international approach in Europe, North America, Australia, New Zealand is to have both possessory security and security by registration. Does that help?
I think that's very helpful. Thank you, Camino.
Okay, thank you very much for the question, Jeremy, and for the answers. And Oliver Mundell, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just following on from that, I mean, I guess if you're in possession of something, you know, then it's lower risk. So I guess at that lower end of the market as well, where people have credit sort of issues and other things, there is an advantage potentially to the individual or small business, you know, in still being able to hand the item over in terms of the cost of...
Well, it's lower risk for the creditor. Because, and this is the same for security rights generally, whether they're created by delivery or by registration, the lending is lower risk because they've got an asset which they can go against. For the debtor, it's better because in general, secured lending attracts lower interest rates. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure in terms of risk of losing the asset, it particularly makes a difference whether there's delivery or not. The most important security in Scotland is the standard security, the mortgage of land. And the absolute core of the standard security, like in all other countries, is the debtor stays in possession. You don't have to give the keys of your house to the bank to get mortgage finance. So in many ways, what this bill is doing is introducing the same type of security as we typically grant over our houses for movable property without having to hand the thing over. And if it's movables, I mean, for pawn, something like a watch doesn't take up storage space. But if it's a bigger asset, if it's a company's vehicles or computers, that will take up storage space and will increase the cost because the creditor's got to store. So typically non-possessory finance is better actually for both the creditor and debtor.
Okay.
I say typically that.
That's why I referred to the lower end, because I think, you know, there's obviously a cost in recovery,
sure,
and effort involved you know, for the debtor in doing that.
Yes, and I know, I notice that you've had written evidence along these lines that there's a worry that the cost may be higher because, say, it's a vehicle, it's got to be recovered. The same argument can be made for houses, that ultimately to enforce a security against a house, the house has got to be recovered. So
they're generally of higher value. A house,
yes,
you know, and that balances out the risk for the...
To some extent, and that is why creditors wouldn't take security over very low value assets anyway. It would have to be something worth several thousand pounds, I think, realistically.
I'll come back to that question in the sort of later, but I was just interested in how the register might work in practice, and I guess, you know, particularly at that lower end as well. You've said, you know, it could be cheaper, more efficient, and you know that it can access finance immediately. But it's just how it would work in practice, because I guess the process of registering your house or registering some other legal documents in Scotland can end up being quite clunky, costly, and just how that would actually how you'd envisage that working.
I will start. Maybe Professor Gretton will follow. The international norm in this area is for electronic registers and for documentation that is limited, fairly standard form documentation, and also in these registers, the keeper, the registrar, will not check the documentation. So the system is basically automated. So the process of registration in the international norm, in what we have based our work on in terms of looking at comparative jurisdictions, is the registration will be relatively cheap. It will be very different from land registration, and of course a standard security, a mortgage, has got to go to the land register. There the keeper has to check things, and there's a huge challenge with land registration about the mapping. We've got to make sure that the mapping of your land doesn't overlap with the neighbouring landowner's land, and that has meant the land register has been and indeed is a relatively costly register. For these registers, there's no mapping. I mean, in theory, one could have a photograph of an object to help describe it, but I doubt that will happen. So, as registers go, it should be a relatively cheap register to run. For the most part, it should be automated. And because it's automated, that means the charges to register something or to search should also be relatively low. I say, again, in line with international standards. George.
Just come in, just a couple of points. One is, as Andrew said, in practice, it's only going to be larger value assets that people are going to be interested in anyway. We're not going to be talking about securities over biros, for example. So the costs have to be looked at in that connection. The second thing I'd mention is that often securities are enforced not directly, but because the debtor's gone bankrupt. Now, where a debtor becomes bankrupt or is a company goes into liquidation or administration, because with companies there are different regimes, as there are indeed for personal bankruptcy, enforcement may be by the insolvency administrator. And then what happens is they sell the vehicles, suppose it's the vehicles, and then the secured creditor of those vehicles gets paid in preference. So there isn't actually, in many cases, any actual enforcement by the secured creditor himself. There may be, it depends on the circumstances. But very often, if the debtor's not paying the secured creditor, they're probably not paying other people either, in which case it's very likely to be an insolvency situation. And as I say, in which case there's no special enforcement, the question doesn't really arise because the insolvency administrator will be selling everything anyway.
No, that's helpful. I'll come.
Can I just a brief point? I would not generally expect debtors to be looking at these registers in the same way as the average business or consumer doesn't look at the land register, even although with the Scottish Land Information Service it's now very easy to do. But for the most part, we leave registers to our legal advisors So I wouldn't normally be expecting the businesses or consumers to be actually looking at these registers in the same way as they typically don't look at the land register.
No, that's helpful. There's also been, I think, some concerns around, you know, privacy, and I'd just be interested to know kind of what thoughts.
Yes,
have on that
is an important issue, particularly for natural persons. In other words, I suppose humans rather than corporate bodies. But again, we can draw on international comparators and look at how other systems have dealt with this. What the Law Commission suggested and the government has taken forward is that for natural persons, only the month and year of birth will show up. Now, there may be only one George Gretton, but there are more than one Andrew Stevens out there. And if you just have Andrew Stephen, okay, you have the address, but, you know, the date of birth in many ways takes you that bit further. But in terms of what would be publicly viewable, it would only be the month and year of birth, and that follows Cumley's House. So Cumley's House in the UK, where one can, at an instant, find out if anyone is a director of a company, one can find that information, but one will only get their month and year of birth. So we drew particularly on the existing model operating in the UK, which is Cumley's House. So yes, that's a very a valid concern. The detail of the registers will be done by statutory instrument, and I'm sure that such issues will be carefully considered at that stage as well.
No, that again is helpful, and I'm sure they will. So I wanted to move on to kind of some of the consumer issues, but I know a few times we've mentioned that in practice it will only be for high value items, and it just was a first before sort of going into the consumer stuff in particular, just around the kind of minimum sums involved. I mean, that's obviously had quite a lot of pickup outside the Parliament, and I know that you've made representations already on that, but it just was to understand where the £1,000 came from, and what you think is the right amount, the right threshold, and why you kind of went for this model of having a fixed sum rather than trying to identify the type of movable goods that it should apply to.
Very briefly, the amount would be for the Scottish Government. The figure was in there because it was felt as a drafting issue. There should be some initial figure.
Perhaps under the affirmative procedure, perhaps. I would need to look at that again. So in other words, in theory, Parliament, assuming there's a statutory instrument power in the bill, I see this as being checked, but obviously the bill is not in its final form, but the affirmative procedure could potentially provide another check, if you like, beyond the Scottish Government. Sorry, Professor Gretton.
That's a good point. So I think one shouldn't take that £1,000 figure too seriously. And I think most people would suggest it derives from the Commission report of 5 years ago. So of course that £1,000 is it's worth less than it was when I arrived in this committee room. But that would be for future consideration. Yes.
But I mean, just to push you a little bit. I mean, you're the kind of experts on this. You came up, with these proposed changes. You say that they're needed. It's kind of at what level do you envisage them kicking in? Because I mean, it's difficult without a figure or a sort of type of, a sort of type of property to get your head round. Yeah. Is this designed? I mean, it's one of the things that's come up in relation to consumers. But is it designed to cover household goods?
No, absolutely not. Can I maybe say where the £1,000 came from? It came from the debt arrangement and attachments, or is that the right way around? Debt Arrangement Attachment Scotland Act 2002, which is about diligence, and the figure appears in that. So you can't go against certain assets below that figure. That was its origin. However, there's a statutory instrument which is referred to in my written evidence from 2010, which says that for vehicles it's actually £3,000. although even if you search the official databases, the 2002 Act still says £1,000, which is misleading. So I would suggest for motor vehicles it should be at least £3,000 to match that figure. Professor Gretton's right. The bill provides for the figure to be set by ministers, taking account of what's considered appropriate at the time. I agree with him that £1,000 is on the low side. It was proposed in 2017. We're now in 2022. Probably the legislation will not come in until 2024 at the latest, because the detailed work in the registers at the earliest, because obviously the statute instruments that will be needed, plus the work on the registers, needs to be done. So 2024 is another 2 years away, and I would hope the government at that point, you know, obviously looked at that very carefully. But yes, higher than £1,000 now that we are where we are. But the bill is deliberately designed to be agile. So ultimately, this figure is by statutory instrument, because our view, in line with international comparators, was that we couldn't find a system that, in terms of reform over the last 20 years, which just said no consumers. What we found was that the reforms were applied to consumers, but with special protections. And again, I can refer to this World Bank report from 2019, which I will leave, which says a secure transactions law should apply to any type of grantor, whether an entity or individual getting financing for business or consumer purposes. The rights of consumer grantors and debtors are typically also addressed through consumer protection legislation that may limit the extent to which a security right may be created, e.g. up to 60% of wages. The bill actually says no assignation for wages, so it's 100%. Or enforced, e.g. a security right may not be enforced in some household goods. Mr. Mundell, to be absolutely clear, the Scottish Law Commission's policy was not household goods. The £1,000 figure was seen as a simpler rule rather than the diligence rule. So I am absolutely clear the figure should be set at a level to exclude ordinary household goods.
I mean, I guess in terms of the sort of horse has bolted a little bit, and there's now a lot of interest in that aspect of the bill. And I just wonder whether you think there would be any negative in putting something on the face of the bill, because I know it's possible at the moment through sort of secondary instruments, sort of other things, to exclude items from being covered by the bill, but whether there's merit in just putting it, in plain English on the face of the bill that.
More precise?
Or just the ordinary household goods or essential household goods.
Oh, I see what you mean.
Are excluded from the provisions of this bill. Is there a negative?
That's a possible way forward. Yep.
The bill enables the Scottish ministers to provide specific categories which cannot be subject to security. So the Scottish ministers could say household goods excluded, so that is in the bill as an option.
Yeah, but that's a ministerial thing. I'm saying it might provide reassurance to some of the parties who've commented on the bill to move it onto the face of the bill, so that it's there in primary legislation. And it's whether you see any negative to excluding excluding ordinary household goods from these provisions up front.
I'll give that one to Andrew, but can I just add another comment, which is background. The statutory pledge would still be subject, where a consumer is concerned, to the regime of the Consumer Credit Act. So that would automatically kick in. The bill doesn't say it would be subject to the Consumer Credit Act, because that applies automatically. So that regulatory regime would be applicable anyway. Andrew, go back to the
question. I would want to reflect on it, but not immediately. In other words, I don't have an immediate objection to it. I think the concern with simply saying you may not have a statutory pledge in respect of property which cannot be the subject of diligence, which is certain household goods that are listed in ours, is that the rules are spread across at least five sections in the 2002 Act, and they're also nuanced. So I think the motor vehicle provision, which is 3,000 now, says something like, insofar as needed by the family. So we then get into a factual discussion over, was that vehicle actually needed by the family or not, or did they have a second vehicle? Whereas the financial limit was designed to make it a lot more simple. If an asset was below that figure,
I guess in terms of consumer protection, maybe it, from policy, I understand from a legal point of view, or from a technical point of view, it's easier. But maybe they are questions we should be asking. Are we allowing people to secure debt against things that they can't live without?
It's legitimate.
I mean, the interesting thing is that when the Law Commission for England and Wales did a report on a similar area, on what they called goods mortgages, they started with an idea of having a power to exclude certain goods, such as household goods. But in their final report, they dropped it. This is in my written evidence, because the evidence to them was that creditors wouldn't be interested in ordinary household goods. But we're agreed that as a matter of policy, such goods should be excluded.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Oliver. And it's online. We have Paul Sweeney, MSP, with us. Paul, if you'd like to ask, please.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you to the Commissioners for their very helpful evidence and statement so far. Just to touch on some of the aspects around consumer protections, just in addition to what Mr. Mundell had mentioned around how we create a mechanism that is effective at protecting consumers, obviously there's been some focus on that £1,000 placeholder. It's been a bit of an unfortunate red herring, perhaps, in hindsight. But we were considering as a committee in private session how we might want to introduce perhaps an amendment to provide automatic controls to that figure. So some sort of deflator that would automatically correct every financial year. If we were to do something like that, would you, endorse such a mechanism, or would you say it was a reasonable undertaking and perhaps assist us in designing it in that way? Just out of interest.
I think it sounds reasonable. I assume, and I think the answer to this is yes, Mr. Sweeney, if it was to be done here, it should probably be done in the diligence legislation as well, and probably in other places. So I just wonder to what extent there might be a wider way of doing that, but it seems eminently sensible to me as a matter of policy, as a matter of technically achieving it. I'm slightly nervous about you asking us to help, but we would be willing so to do. I just wonder if there are precedents in other legislation, which no doubt the Scottish Government lawyers and us could look into, but I would suggest it's something that would be best done more widely, actually, particularly in relation to the diligence provisions. Professor Grissom?
That's a perfectly reasonable suggestion. There's a systemic issue here. In the criminal law, there's a system of the standard scale. And so with criminal penalties, you don't have to name the figure, which is then subject to the problem of the changing value of money. The legislation simply says that the fine will be at 0.5 of the standard scale or whatever it happens to be. And then the standard scale can be adjusted every now and again, and it all works smoothly. So that's criminal law. But on the civil side, this approach has never been adopted. And that often does cause problems with figures getting out of date and governments not getting around to passing the necessary statutory instruments to update them. So there's a systemic issue here, I think. As I say, your particular idea, I'd certainly have no objection to it.
Well, that's reassuring, and it's perhaps something the committee members can reflect on as we go forward in this process. So thank you for that. I think more broadly, we'd be interested in understanding more about what the Commission did to seek views of consumer groups, and what was the sort of feedback that was received or evidence that was received in the course of preparing the draft legislation.
It's something which we did in 2012 or 2013. We went to discuss our policy proposals, as they were, which were sort of within the Commission at that stage, with Consumer Focus Scotland in Glasgow. And I remember specifically discussing the diligence exception, or in other words, the financial limit rather than excluding goods except from diligence. And having discussed that with Consumer Focus Scotland, they were content that consumers were included, but they were keen to keep in touch in terms of further detail. Consumer Focus Scotland was abolished, so that, of course, did not happen. We looked in terms of the question of whether lending would actually be made to consumers, so we discussed with one of our advisory group members, Bruce Wood, who knows a lot in this area and had worked heavily in this area with the Consumer Credit Trade Association, with the Financial Leasing Association, and their evidence to us was that this could bring, and indeed would bring, benefits to consumers in terms of the potential for lower interest rates. There were then subsequent consultations on the bill. There was a consultation on the sort of final draft of the bill in the summer of 2017 before the report was published at the end of 2017. There was a consultation done by the Economy Committee in 2019 into 20, and the Scottish Government did a targeted consultation. And these were all opportunities for consumers to engage. We made specific attempts to engage with law centres to get their views. That did not result in a response. But we regarded the consumer element as a very sensitive one, and one where it was important to get evidence. We were influenced by the fact this is how reforms have been done in other countries. It's unusual to leave consumers out. But the original discussion paper has questions on consumers, and we did our best in the ensuing period to highlight the consumer aspects of the bill. Ultimately, people are busy. I have noticed in law reform before that sometimes those who respond to a parliamentary committee's call for evidence haven't engaged at an earlier date, and some stakeholders who've engaged in consultation one, when it gets to consultation five, they're a little bit fatigued. So I would invite you to look at responses to earlier consultations as well as this one. But yes, we were very sensitive to the fact that consumers raise particular issues. I suppose one final point, in the same way as I talked earlier about small businesses not understanding wheel transactions laws, in the same way as I don't understand plumbing and smartphones, there's a similar challenge with consumers because the area is technical. Professor Gerson?
Yeah, I would agree with all that. Could I just come back very briefly to an earlier point about exclusion of household goods? I was a bit vague in my response. I would have no objection to hardwiring that into the bill. There may be a slight difference between me and Andrew here.
No,
okay.
With that as well.
I don't think it's a big issue because, as I say, it can be done by a statute instrument anyway. But if it was thought desirable to hardwire it into the bill, yeah. That I think would be not unreasonable. Yeah.
Paul, anything further?
Yeah, no, that's a helpful background, and it certainly provides some degree of reassurance around some of the commentary that we've heard around the proposed legislation. And picking up on the point that was mentioned about responses from law centres, obviously there's been a response received from the Govan Law Centre in particular. And it has effectively kind of compared the enforcement of statutory pledges to warrant sales. And we assume that you don't think this is a fair characterisation. And just to offer some particular sections of the bill, that are cited in relation to this. Section 60 entitling a creditor to serve a pledge enforcement notice on a debtor where payment has not been made. And then Section 65, enabling an authorised person, in other words, a sheriff officer, to enter someone's home to remove movable goods subject to the statutory pledge. And Section 66 of the Bill giving a creditor the right to sell someone's movable goods at a public auction. Obviously, bear in mind we've had discussion around the protections we can introduce around particular goods and household vulnerability and exposure and so on. Could you just explain in more detail why you think this particular characterisation of warrant sales isn't a particularly fair one, and that allows us to kind of understand more of context?
Which was the first section you mentioned? I just didn't hear it. I got the other ones.
Apologies. 63, maybe? The right to sell.
63, 65 and 66.
Thank you.
The characterisation as a warrant sale is incorrect. The Scottish Law Commission was behind the legislation which replaced warrant sales. So the idea that the Scottish Law Commission would support the reintroduction of warrant sales is wrong. We've discussed the exclusion of household goods, so therefore that would mean that a sheriff officer was not coming to somebody's house because ordinary household goods are excluded. The particular provision about auction is drawn from Saskatchewan, where it says that if the creditor is buying the property, it's got to be an auction. And that's it's an enhanced debtor protection provision to make sure that best value is got. But what I would say about auctions is that just about every other debt enforcement process involves auctions. So a pawnbroker could auction. A holder of a standard security could auction. Someone doing diligence could auction. A trustee in sequestration could auction. And in other countries, the idea of selling or particularly auctioning is just standard. So to characterise the statutory pledge as sort of as unique in terms of auctioning is wrong. Now, I've read the Government Law Centre response, and it referred to certain checks and balances, and I'm more than happy to consider what further protections could be brought in so that protections that might exist in the diligence of attachment would also apply here. That seems entirely reasonable. But I would suggest that if we exclude ordinary household goods, this is not going to be happening anyway. One final point: with a warrant sale, the creditor could come in and sell, or sticker and take goods away generally. For a security, the only thing they could remove is what the debtor has voluntarily granting the security over. And if the bill excludes certain property, then that's not going to be possible. Even if the debtor did that, and I know that it might be suggested that vulnerable debtors have no choice, sign here, the only thing which the sheriff officer could remove is what has been identified as for security purposes. Whereas for the warrant sale, for the poll tax, the sheriff officers could come in and sticker, sticker, sticker. So it's a bad analogy. I mean, it may seem the same at first sight, but it's a bad analogy in my view, Professor Gretton.
Yeah, no, I would agree.
Just before I bring Paul back in, Jeremy, are you on that point?
Yeah, can I just push a wee bit on that, Professor Stephen? Because at the moment, we're looking at the bill as is. We're looking maybe to bring amendments, but correct me if I'm wrong, but at the moment, if I buy a television for £1,000, that is then assigned to somebody else in the appropriate way, so it's registered onto a third party, and I stop paying for my television,
yeah,
they can come along after due court process and take my television away.
In the same way as if you had higher purchase the television,
yes,
they could,
yeah,
they could keep it away.
Yeah.
Yet depending on where the financial,
yeah,
limit.
But at the moment, as the bill stands,
assuming depending on the value of it.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep.
So that does, I appreciate it doesn't, you can't go along as we used to do under warrant sales and take every, you know, take stick of everything. But that television would still be removed by show of officers.
If the television had a value of above £1,000, in principle it could. I think, as with higher purchase, it will be relatively unusual with something of a value which is not that high because of the costs of recovery. So in some cases, banks will simply write things off. But yes, if there were not the protections in the bill with the financial threshold and the power to exclude certain goods, then yes, these processes could follow through. The main difference between consumers and businesses, as the bill stands at the moment here, is you need a court order. So there's that protection as well for consumers. They would also need to go through the Consumer Credit Act 1974, which is a 14-day warning notice, and the powers which courts have under that legislation. And you've given me an opportunity to say something which I hope to say at some point, is to be clear, the statutory pledge is not a new product. So I in the sense of consumer credit law. So I know there's a concern, and I'm keen to assuage that concern. I think there's reference to something called Buy Now, Pay Later, which wasn't regulated, and the Financial Conduct Authority had to catch up. It is absolutely clear that the statutory pledge is subject to the Consumer Credit Act 1974, as that Act stands, because it's a type of security, and security is defined in the Act. So, Mr. Balfour, as well as the need to get a court order under the bill, they would need to go through the Consumer Credit Act procedures as well. So that gives that layer too. But I agree, the ordinary television should be excluded, absolutely.
OK, thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Jeremy. Paul, do you have any?
Thank you, Chair. I have no further questions. That was a helpful series of responses, so I'm happy to rest on that. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for the questions, and thank you for the answers. Okay, and finally, we have Jeremy, if you would like to just give us a couple of wee questions at the end, please.
Yep, thank you. Just as we come to an end, I suppose we've discussed about the highlights of the bill and the ones that have perhaps had most responses, both to your initial consultation, but also to the consultation done by the committee. I suppose, are there other things, and you may want to come away and write to us rather than list them all now, but are there other things, maybe small things, which you think the bill needs amended on or looked at to make it even better than it is at the moment? So I suppose what I'm looking for is, our process after this will be to do, and Parliament processes, to bring forward amendments. I'm just wondering, from your perspective, are there any areas that require looking at, however small they might be?
I think there are. So I have tried to read all the responses to the committee, and some of them are, from the legal consultees, are lengthy, and I know the Scottish Government intends to look at these in detail, and they're up to stage two. And I myself have thoughts at a small level, but I don't think we have time to go through it at the moment. So I absolutely think that the detailed points which your consultees have raised should be looked at to come up to that slightly higher level. The thing which is missing from the bill, which was in the Scottish Law Commission report, is financial instruments and shares. And I know legal consultees are particularly keen to see that done. The Scottish Government has said it will be done, provided that UK government agrees under a section 104 order. But if you ask me what's the best way in which the bill could be improved, it would be to put financial instruments back in. But I know there's the legislative competence issue, but I'm delighted the Scottish Government is working to achieve that through a section 104 order.
The expression financial instruments in this context includes shares, which might not be immediately obvious from the terminology. I would agree with that. At the moment, intellectual property is in, and that's excellent. So if a new business has intellectual property, it's worth £100,000, they can now grant security over it, which under current law is possible by a workaround, which is highly unsatisfactory in all sorts of ways. Yes, it's very important the shares should come in, and if an 104 order is necessary, well, I hope it can be obtained here. In terms of, there are drafting issues, but they're too technical, and that's the big policy one, to make sure that other intangibles come in and not just IP.
Yeah, I mean, perhaps you could come back to us if there are technical things you would like us in writing. I suppose just my final question was going to be around the financial instruments and them being in your draft bill, but not within the Scottish Government Bill. And this is maybe an unfair question to ask you, but I'll ask it anyway. And that is, do you agree with Scottish Government that it is incompetent for them to have it within the bill? And do you think if it was put back into the bill, it would be competent?
We're talking about financial instruments.
We are, yes.
I've not looked at that question carefully. My general impression was that it would be competent to have them in. But, of course, legislative competence is a difficult area, and I've not looked at it in detail.
I have not seen the Scottish Government's detailed legal opinion on that. So I would need to see that to see if the view which we took in the report that it was included was in fact misplaced. But I can understand the government wants to be cautious. They don't want a situation where it was challenged on the basis of legislative competence. But I it's not something I've been able to look at in detail because I haven't seen the internal opinion which the Scottish Government did on that. But the fact that the policy decision is to implement, albeit via the Section 104 order route, I'm very pleased. But I think what you'll hear from the Law Society, perhaps, or other lawyers working in this area, that they're keen that it moves forward as well. So although it has to be done by Section 104 order, when the legislation comes into force, it all comes into force. There's not a lag with the financial instrument stuff. There are real issues here. But it's a really good example of Scots law being inadequate. So under Scots law, you have to transfer the shares into the bank's name, and then the bank therefore has to report for persons of significant control and other all sorts of other administrative requirements, which puts up costs. It means you can't create securities over shares more than once, because you can only transfer once. Who gets the dividends? Who gets the vote at the AGM? None of this is an issue in England. But in Scotland, the only way you can do it is you transfer it into the bank's name, and it definitely needs to be addressed. So I am pleased the Scottish Government has committed to do that. Of course, on their view, they're dependent on the UK Government, so I hope the committee will support the Scottish Government in pressing the UK Government to have this taken through.
We've mentioned physical assets quite a lot in this meeting, but intangible assets are hugely important. Scots law really has to fix this problem. IP, shares, maybe other things as well, yeah.
I've just been reading my notes. Just one quick other question I had, which is completely unrelated to that question. I'm picking up something my colleague, Mr. Mundell, was talking about, and that is in regard to being able to look at the register and how often you can do that. And my understanding is, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that we're limiting the opportunity for people to do searches on that.
No. It would be a public register like the land register, but the way in which you could search would be limited. The standard approach is that you can only search against the grantor of the statutory pledge or the assignor. There's a commercial reason, which is if you can search against the assignee or the creditor, you get their customer list.
So if you could search against Bank of Scotland PLC, vast numbers, and you get details of the customers here.
OK, sorry, thank you. I clarified the point I was asking.
Yeah, but if you search against George Cratton, 52 Grange Loan, you'll get nothing.
The registers will be mainly used by would-be creditors to check whether you've already done it. Yeah. And insolvency officials, they'll not be checked by consumers, particularly in assignation. Consumers will simply not look at it. And there was a concern about consumers having to pay search fees. They absolutely don't need to look at it.
Thank you for clarifying that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jeremy. Thanks to all of our committee members for the questions, and the questions are exhausted, as may well be our witnesses, but thank you very much indeed, because that's been extraordinarily helpful. So I want to thank Lady Payton, Professor Gretton and Professor Stephen for extremely helpful evidence. And I might ask Lady Payton if it will be acceptable if the committee may follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from the meeting.
Yes, that would be very acceptable. In fact, can we express our gratitude for this opportunity to discuss and hopefully assist with the progress of the bill. So, yes, a written follow-up would be very welcome.
Well, thank you very much indeed. That's very kind of you. We'll let you go now. So I'll suspend the meeting briefly to allow our witnesses to leave the room. And thank you very much. Thank you. We're considering instruments subject to the affirmative procedure, and no points have been raised on the draft homeless persons suspension of referrals between local authorities Scotland Order 2022 and the draft Social Security Miscellaneous Amendment and Transitional Provision Scotland Regulations 2022. Is the committee content with these instruments? And we are, and thank you very much for that. So under agenda item 5, we are considering instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. And no points have been raised on SSIs 2022, 274, 275 and 277. Is the committee content with these instruments? And we appear to be, so that's great. So as agreed earlier, I'll now move the meeting into private. And thank you.